Chad really needs no introduction per se, but I'd just like to say as he comes up how grateful I am for him. He's just a faithful, wonderful, dynamic pastor, and the students in the high school ministry love him. Parents have just so supported him and love him so much. I'm also not just his boss, but I'm also one of the parents of one of the kids in the group, and so I get to hear a lot about all that God's doing in the high school ministry. And Chad, I just want you to know how much I praise God for you. Just a great brother, a wonderful friend, and we love you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, brother. And anytime Chad preaches, you know he brings things with him. So it's like we have one today, too.
Thank you so much, Brian, for the introduction. Thank you, guys. Hey, today is a special day. So March 4th, 2014, I got hired on here at Mission Hills Church. I started here, right? I only say that because I need to hear you guys applaud for me before I preach, and then afterwards you can do whatever you want, but at least I got that from you now, right? So that means that today is the day, this is my third year anniversary that me and my family have been here at Mission Hills Church, and I just want to let you guys know that it has been an absolute honor. It has been an absolute privilege. You guys are my family members, and I just want to thank you, all of you here, and Brian and the rest of the staff, for welcoming me, my wife, and now my two little boys here at Mission Hills Church. I had two kids while here at this church. In 3 years, my life has drastically changed. If you have kids, you know what I'm talking about, right? Woo! I am still not sleeping 3 years later, and it's awesome. But thank you guys so much for having me here at Mission Hills Church. I've grown. These have been formative years in my walk with Jesus, and I just want to thank you for your hospitality. For your care, for your love, and for you welcoming me into this family, this church family. It is an honor to serve at this church, so thank you so much. Hey, before we start, would you pray with me? Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you so much for the crazy opportunity that you keep giving me to come up and stand before your people and before people in this world and talk about you, the best thing ever. So good. God, I pray now that you would use me in all the capacities that you've created me to be, to praise and glorify and worship you. God, I pray that we would sit here and we would show up because you are here in this place. We don't have to ask you to come because you are already in this place. So I pray that we would show up to where you are here. God, I pray that you would open our hearts and our minds, that you would get rid of all the distractions that may have accumulated on the drive over here, maybe from the past week or because tomorrow's Monday and we have to face the week again. I pray that you would just let all those things fall and we would be able to sit here and just abide in you. So God, we give you this time. We're excited to get into your word and hear more about who you are and what you have for us in this place. It's in Jesus' name we all said, amen, amen, amen. Hey, so can I share a story with you from my first year here? And I just want to warn you, this is a story of doubt and of faith, okay? So can I share my doubt with you, right? That's kind of a weird thing to say in a sermon, right? Now, but now you guys are listening, so perfect. So I want to share a story of doubt and then, of course, a story of faith. So I started here, like I said, 3 years ago. 3 years ago. And the first week I was here, I walked down to the underground, and that's where our high school service is held. And it was Sunday, now it's Tuesday night. I walk down and I share my story with my wife, and it's awesome. It's a great time, at least for me. I don't know about for them, but it was awesome. And I share my story, and then, you know, we meet students, we hug them, we get to know them, and I'm excited. And then the second week, I go. And I'm on maternity leave now because I had my first son. Well, I didn't, but my wife had our first son, Gray, right? And so I take 2 weeks off. So just a precursor, before all this happened, before I got hired here at Mission Hills Church, I had been a drug addict. I was addicted to heroin. I was homeless and living in San Francisco. Some of you guys know that, some of you don't. And God pulled me out of that. And he rescued me and saved me and then quickly put me to work in ministry. So before I was hired here, I was working as an evangelist on high school campuses. from Los Angeles to San Diego, and I would go and I'd preach the gospel to students. I was also serving at a local church in Costa Mesa called the Crossing Church, which is a huge recovery church, and I just so happened to end up in their backyard living in an apartment, and one day walked over, and then I walked over and I signed up to serve in the youth ministry, and before I knew it, they put me up on a stage to share my story within only a couple of months of being a Christian, and I shared the gospel to 1,000 students who didn't know Christ, most of them, and almost half of them came to know Jesus. Crazy, right? Yeah. What the heck? This is so funny. I preached the Romans Road. I didn't even know what the Romans Road was, but verbatim, if you know what that is. Like, this is my first Bible. It's marked up in here, okay, 1, 2, 3. And then later on, they're like, how do you know the Romans Road? I was like, I don't. He's like, that's weird. Yep, Jesus is alive. I guess not that weird. So, right? So within 3 years as an evangelist, I had the opportunity, and I say this humbly, it's hard to say, but I had the opportunity to see more than 1,000 students come to know Jesus. And it was just such a blessing to be part of that story. And then I got hired here, Mission Hills Church. I was so eager. I just graduated from Vanguard University with a degree in religion and ministry leadership, and I was fired up and ready to go. I was ready to come to this church and just lay it down. I was filled with passion and energy. Can you smell the pride, right? I was going to bring it for Jesus to this church. I was going to change it all, right? No. But I came into this church, and like I said, I the first week I shared my story, and then second week we had a baby, and I remember sitting there on those 2 weeks off just sitting with my baby and looking into Gray's eyes and being filled with so much love for this little precious baby, and then something very weird began to happen during those 2 weeks. To be honest, all of a sudden, I was filled with doubt. I was consumed by fear. For the first time since being a Christian, all of a sudden, I started to feel like I was uncalled, unqualified, and unequipped to be at this church and to be a pastor. Just to be honest with you guys, that's how I felt during these 2 weeks. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was the weight of holding a new life that I was responsible for. If you're a parent, you know that feeling, right? Your heart has now jumped outside of you and is running around or crawling around, and you have to take care of it, and it's so vulnerable. Like Amy, my wife, she'd be cool if anything happened, right? She's an adult. But now I have this baby, right? A baby to take care of. So I was filled with doubt. I felt unequipped, uncalled for the first time as a Christian. The passion that I once had, the energy that I once had, all those plans and ideas and vision for the ministry that I had just started to kind of fade and crumble away. And I became overwhelmed. And I remember sitting there thinking, I am not ready for this. I was consumed by fear, so unequipped. It was like a mini dark night of the soul, if you guys know what that is. If not, don't worry about it. So, the week I come back, I'm going to preach my first message ever to the high school students. That week, our staff just so happened to be attending a leadership conference, a Christian leadership conference called Catalyst at Mariners Church. If you know anything about Catalyst, it is like the Super Bowl of leadership conferences. It is high energy. The best speakers are there. All of the top church and church leaders are there. I think like Hillsong United played and Phil Wickham played at the same time. It was like crazy. There's literally like cannons of confetti blowing up in my face. And I'm sitting there like, oh my gosh, what am I even doing here? Right? This is a conference where they teach you how to grow your church in 10 ways or whatever. You know what I mean? Like the top speakers come out and teach you how to like raise up the next generation and like all this energy. And it's good. I'm not bashing Catalyst. I love it. But at the spot that I was in, I was sitting there just feeling like this is way too much. Have you ever been there? Yeah. Where someone's preaching content at you, but all you really need is someone just to hold you. That's what I felt like. So I'm sitting there at Catalyst West. And the speaker comes out, and he's like, everyone's like rolling on the ground laughing, and there's still confetti like blowing up in my face, and I'm sitting there so overwhelmed. And I remember just getting up out of my seat and walking out of that building, saying, I can't stand another word. I just need to leave. And so I got up out of my seat, and I walked out of the building. If you've ever been to Mariners Church in Irvine, it's this big building. And I walk out, and I walk down this path, and there's this little chapel there. It's just glass and wood, and it's beautiful. If you've ever been there, you know what I'm talking about. It's just this beautiful little chapel. And I walk into this chapel, and Catalyst had set up a place for reflection and devotion. I'm like, I've died and gone to heaven. This is amazing. I walk in, and there's literally like meditational music, you know? It's like, oh, way better than that, but I try. And I walk in, I'm like, oh, it's a refuge. It's literally a sanctuary, but it's a sanctuary for my soul right now. Like, it's doing its what it's supposed to do, right? And so I walk in, and Catalyst has set up 5 stations where you can go and interact with God in different ways. And so I walk up to the first station. And just a side note, my message that I'm going to preach so faithfully or not so faithfully on is on John 15. John 15 is going to be my first message. And so I walk up to the first station, and it's just a couple chairs, a couple tables, and Bibles. And I'm like, cool. So I walk up, I sit down in a comfy chair, and I look, and there's a Bible, and it's open. And it's open to John 15. And I'm like, perfect. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to just memorize the scripture for my sermon, which is not being in relationship with Jesus. This is devotional. There's a difference between devotional time and hearing from God and being unfaithful and trying to memorize scripture so you can preach well. Like this, there's a huge difference there. So I'm sitting there and I'm reading John 15 for my sermon unfaithfully because I'm like, I need to like do a good job. And I'm sitting there reading it and I'm only being filled up with more anxiety. Like, oh my gosh, what is a vine? What is that? You know, like, and so I get up and I'm like, this is weird. And I get up and I go to the next station, and the next station is a pile of rocks, like a mountain of rocks, and there's other rocks to the side and a Sharpie, and you like grab one of the rocks and you write like a word, and then you throw it onto the pile of rocks, and it's supposed to be this cute like symbolization of how like we're all one in Christ and our stories come together as one, and it's just this really cute thing, right? And so I grab a rock and I write like some pathetic sad word, like a story, you know, I'm broken, like help me or whatever, and I throw it onto the pile of rocks, and it comes crumbling down the pile, and it lands right next to another rock that says John 15, and I'm like, what the heck is going on? It's like God's real. Because at this point, remember, I felt like God's left me. I've seen amazing things, but all that didn't matter because I felt in here like God has left me. But I'm sitting there and I'm like, okay, maybe he's trying to say something. So I walk to, right, I walk to the next station, and it is a station of vines. I kid you not, vines. If you know anything about John 15, it starts with, I am the vine, right? And it's vines, right? And there's paper, again, another cute thing you can interact with God. There's paper, and you like write your story down, and then you take a little clip and clip it onto the vine, and it symbolizes how we're all woven together in this tapestry of grace and Jesus. And so I take a piece of paper and I start writing my story down. God rescued me from drug addiction, and then he used me to do all these really cool, amazing things. And I felt so called and so ready. And then I got the job that God had called me into. And now I feel so uncalled, unprepared, unequipped, and so alone. God, where are you? And then I take that paper and I clip it onto the vine and I back up and just look at the vine. And I kid you not, right next to mine in a different Sharpie color, red Sharpie, bold letters, everything else is in black, red Sharpie, John 15, right next to mine. And I'm like, okay, this is getting creepy, God. You're creepy. No. And so I go to the next station, and to be honest with you, I totally forgot what it is. I forgot what it is, but John 15 pops up in another capacity or whatever. And then this is the crazy part. If the rest of the stuff wasn't crazy already, this is actually the crazy part. I go to the final station, and it is booths where you sit down next to someone, and they intercede on God's behalf for you. They pray, intercessory prayer. And I sit down next to this poor lady, and I don't even say hi to her. I just start emotionally vomiting my life to this poor girl, right? You know? And I'm just telling her how God called, he took me out of drug addiction, and then and you know, he used me for all these awesome things, and then I got this job that I thought he was calling me to, and now I'm thinking maybe I'm not supposed to be there, and how like how God how I'm preaching this sermon on John 15 this week, and it's written, and I don't feel ready to talk about how he's real when I don't even feel him anymore. And then I start sharing with her about how John 15 keeps popping up all over the room as if God is real. And then I look at the poor lady, and she's crying. And I'm like, oh my gosh. I'm shook with reality. I'm like, did I just de-evangelize this lady, if that's a thing? Right? And I look at her. I look at her, and she's crying, and I wake up, you know, out of my stupor of selfishness. And I go, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I didn't even say hi to you. And she looks down at me with tears in her eyes. And she says, it's not that. And I'm like, what? What do you mean it's not that? She goes, when I woke up this morning, I too felt unequipped and uncalled. But I heard God tell me to read John 15 to every single person that sits next to me. I kid you not, I look down and there's a Bible in her lap with a finger in it. And she opens it like this, John 15. And she goes, can I read this over you? Yes, please, read it now, you know. And so she begins to read John 15 over me three times. And then she prays God's power and equip and anointing over my life. And then we hug, and I cry, she cries, and I never see this lady again. But I walk out knowing that God never left me. I might have felt like it, but he never left me. So can I read John 15 over you this morning? Yeah. And can we hear it not as a text that we're going to scientifically just take apart and figure out, but can we read it as God's living word for you today? Can we do that? Let's do it. This is the word of the Lord. John 15. I am the true grapevine, and my Father, he is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit. And then he prunes. He prunes the branches that do bear fruit so that they will produce even more. You have already been pruned and purified by the message I have given you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those of you who remain in me, and I in them, will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does remain in me, doesn't remain in me, is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. That's awesome. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples, and this brings me great glory to the Father. I have loved you even as the Father has loved me, so remain in me, remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love. Just as I obeyed my Father's commandments and remained in his love, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves, because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends, since I have told you everything the Father told me. You didn't choose me. I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. And this is my commandment, love each other. Amen is right. So I leave knowing that God didn't fail me. I leave knowing that sometimes it does feel like he's left me and maybe he has failed me. But I leave knowing that I am called. And I leave knowing whose I am and who I am. I am God's, called for his purpose. And it's awesome. But if you came here today, and you feel like Jesus has let you down, or if you're here today and you feel discouraged or without hope, or if you're here today and you feel like you don't have a purpose, I want to let you know that those feelings are real. And I've been there like I'm sharing, and I continue to go there sometimes. I think it's my disposition, but I just do. And I want to let you know that you are here because God wants to encounter you in those places today. I want to let you know that you don't have to remain there. We don't have to remain in our self-pity. We don't have to remain in our condemnation. We don't have to remain in our shame. We can choose to go and run to Jesus, who is the source of life and joy and peace. Always. Always. Jesus is alive, you guys. He's alive. Here, right now. With us. And when you feel hopeless, when you feel discouraged, you have, I think, two options. You can either remain in your misery, or you can run and remain in Jesus, who will give you life and peace and joy and fill you with his love. And I would argue, if you're a disciple, that's your only task, is to remain connected to the Father. That is the primary task. I titled this message, The Most Important Thing. And I believe, guys, that this is the most important thing, to remain connected to Jesus always. Always. And if you do this, if you get this right, then everything works out. You ever buttoned your shirt, guys, and then gotten the first one wrong and then the rest, right? If you get the first one right, what happens? It all works out, right? It's the same with this. If you get remaining in Jesus right, everything flows from there. Everything flows from there. And if you want to see fruitfulness in your life, God doesn't call you to be fruitful. He just doesn't. He says, remain in me and I will bear fruit through you. Right? Just stay connected. So can we break down this passage just a little bit? We're going to look at it. We're going to break down the first section. I'm not going to get through all 16 verses. Are you grateful for that? But we're going to go through to verse 8. So it says this. John 15, 1 through 3 says, I am the true grapevine, and my Father, he is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit, fruit so that they will produce even more. You have already been pruned and purified by the message that I have given you. So in this text, we see two types of pruning. We see two types of pruning in this text. The first pruning is the pruning of the disciple, the pruning of the person who follows Jesus faithfully, who is connected to Jesus. The Father, like Jesus says, is the gardener that prunes or cuts away from the disciple, meaning he removes things that are not beneficial to you. It's that simple. Have you guys ever felt this, though? Right? Does it feel good? No. It hurts. I used to be a drug addict. Drugs felt good. But then when he pruned me of that, I literally had a stroke. It was painful. But at the end of it is joy. Now I have what? A wife, a job, kids, life. And I'm not saying that Jesus promises those things to anyone, but I can guarantee that it's better than the things that are holding you back. There is a well-known rapper, hip-hop artist, named Chance the Rapper, who literally brought a worship service to the Grammys this year. If you haven't seen it, check it out. It is amazing. So cool. He grew up in Chicago. He says he's was heavily influenced by gangster rap, and because of those influences and where he grew up in Chicago, he found himself at an early age addicted to drugs and at a very early age in jail. Chance revealed that one day during this time that he was still doing drugs, he went to his grandmother's house in Chicago, and he says to only be greeted by a stern-looking face. You guys know that face, right? That's the face you never want to see. Cute grandma, mad. Get away, run. Chance's popularity at this time as a young hip-hop artist was on the rise, but his grandmother seemed not to be impressed with his popularity at all. She said this to him, Chance, I don't like what's going on. I can see it in your eyes. I don't like this. We are going to pray right now. And then she prayed a prayer that Chance said sounded more like a curse than a prayer. Cute grandma throwing it down. She spoke out loud saying this, Lord, I pray that all things that are not like you, that you take them away from Chance. That you make sure that he fails at everything that is not like you. Take it away, turn it into dust. That's a Lent prayer right there, if I ever seen one, right? Turn it into dust. Take it away. Also at this time, Chance found out that his unborn daughter, who was in his, had a heart condition. And for some reason, that day, he accepted his grandmother's prayer and realized that it was the push that he needed to make his way back to God. His baby's health problems also prompted Chance to pray every single day. And miraculously, his daughter, Kinsley Bennett, was born without any complications in 2015. A few months later, Chance decided to turn his life around for good, and in February 2016, he tweeted this, Today is the last day of my old life, the last day of smoking cigs. I don't know what, pruning, I guess. He said, headed to church for help. All things are possible through Christ who strengthens me. Now, in May 2016, he released his third mixtape, Coloring Book, which had over 57.3 views or listens in just its first week. In the album, Chance shows his newfound faith in Jesus and raps about things, Christian thoughts, and candid admissions of sin like lust and greed and pride. His hit Blessings, he proudly sings out, "I'm gonna praise him. I'm gonna praise him till he's gone, good God." Or when the praises go up, the blessings come down. With Coloring Book, Chance won 2016 BET Hip Hop Award for Mixtape, Best Mixtape, BET Hip Hop Award for Best New Hip Hop Artist, and Soul Train Music Award for Best New Artist. If you watch him at the Grammys, I don't know what award he got, but every single sentence, I've never seen this in history, he says, "I want to thank you, Lord. I want to thank you, Lord." And you're like, yes, this is so cool. Look, I'm not saying if you give your life to Jesus, I'm not saying that you're going to become a rock star or a hip-hop artist. Some of you guys are like, yeah, well, I don't even want that. I'm not saying that things are going to get better. I'm not saying your life's going to get better. That is not promised in Scripture. Well, sometimes you get abundant life. You get something better. You get things that are like eternal, not earthly, and it's awesome. But what I am saying is if you remain in Jesus, I believe if you follow Jesus closely, he will prune you of what is not from him. And I will argue that is the greatest blessing you can receive. If you've ever been trapped in drug addiction, when you encounter God and he takes that away, you've been pruned of that, you know what I'm talking about. If you ever had a pornography addiction and you felt a slave to this thing that you hate, and you're freed from it, and it's pruned from you, God, over years maybe, sometimes quickly, sometimes long, but when it's removed, man, you're grateful. You are grateful. That's the pruning process. That's the pruning process. I think that being pruned is just another word for discipline, which we're just coming out of a series, right, called The Art of Living, where Brian, it was just so well done, preached about spiritual disciplines. And I want to cover a couple of verses on the disciplines in Hebrews. God's discipline, as the writer of Hebrews says this, is not enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful. But afterwards, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained up in his ways. How good is that? And we do this not by being lazy, but by getting up and going and letting him work through us. You will fail as a Christian. That's inevitable. But if you abide in him, he will infinitely pick you up. You will repent. He will restore you. You may be hurt. You may be broken, but you will never be destroyed if you keep going to the Father. Ever. So continue to abide in him. Hebrews 12, 1 through 12, the beginning of this, says this: "Let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us." And we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, heavenly things, the champion who initiated and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor besides God's throne. If we keep our eyes on Jesus, he's our champion. It's because of him that our faith becomes perfected. It's not because of us, it's because of him and what he's done. All he calls you to do is stay connected to him. Primary things. Stay connected to the Father. And if you have an addiction, If you're here right now and you feel like you're being held down by a sin or an addiction, and you feel like a slave to that, you feel like you're in bondage, I want to let you know that it starts and finishes in Jesus. That Jesus will take you through that, and he will finish it, and he will cut it off, because he is our perfecter, because he is our champion, because he is your savior, and because he is the good gardener that cuts everything from you that prevents you from growing and transforming and bearing fruit for his kingdom. And he does this as a good, good father, as we sang, and as the writer of Hebrew writes this: The Lord disciplines his own as a father disciplines his children. And all of this is for whose good? Our good. Our good. So that we may share in his holiness. This, you guys, I would argue, is what we really want. We don't really want a nice house in a gated community with a ton of cars. You don't really want that. You don't really want to retire at 35 and play golf until you die. You really just don't want that. You might want that. I don't know. But if you do, you have bad goals. Like, come on. Really, like, we don't want that. At the core of us, that's not what we were made for. And you can feel that weight. Trust me, talk to a guy who's retired and plays golf all the time. How enjoyable is it? It's okay, right? What we want, and what we've made for is holiness, is purity, is being faithfully connected to the one who is so holy, who is so good, that we just want to be with him forever. And we want to walk with him on the journey that he has for us and invite people into this amazing thing so that they can be removed or pruned of all those things that are holding them back from living a real life, a true life in him. I don't know about you, but I have a hard time dealing with people that annoy me. Just gonna get by that laugh, I guess you do too, right? And I think Jesus dealt with people that annoyed him too. Jesus was a human. He felt those emotions. And I think this is exactly the point Jesus is making in this text. If you remain in him, that he will prune you, he will discipline you, he will train you, and in the end, you'll be so filled with his joy that you'll be able to love anybody, and your joy will overflow, even and especially the people that annoy you. How good is that? Come on. Like, that's real life. That's real living, right? To be trained by the creator of heaven and earth. Remember where we are in John chapter 15 in the Gospel of John as he reads this. When Jesus spoke this parable, he had just left the disciples, or he's with the disciples, but they had just left the upper room where Jesus literally just told them that he was going to die for them, right? That they would betray him and let him down. And he's on the road to the Garden of Gethsemane where he prays, and the author of the Gospel of Luke writes that he is sweating blood drops. Like, that's what he had to face. He knew he was going to face something horrible for these people that constantly let him down. And he did it regardless. He faced the cross for us. So that if we believe in him and remain in him, we can live connected to him for eternity. Jesus continues and says this to his disciples on that road. He says this: remain in me and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But If you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. So, this is a grapevine. I bought it this week from a guy named Patrick at Green Thumb Nursery. If you want to hear the gospel, go talk to Patrick. He's preaching it all day long. It's awesome. He uses plants. It's amazing. But I go there, and this is the grapevine, right? And this right here is the vine, if you don't know anything about grapevines. This part is the vine, right? And these little guys right here are what? The branches, right? Jesus, us, right? And so I need this. I don't know if you guys do, but I need to see the visual. This is a pathetic, small plant. I get it. The big ones, they've already been trimmed, but this is all I could find. So this right here is Jesus, the vine. The vine. The second type of pruning here is what Jesus says is the pruning of those who continuously decide not to turn to him and abide in him. And Jesus, because he's a God of love, he says, okay. Because love doesn't force others to love them back. And he says, if that's what you want, this is what happens. And so he cuts those vines that aren't producing any fruit. And he lets them gather. And they're useless. And they're burned. And that's it. We can choose. He gives us that right to choose to follow him. And then he cuts you off if you choose not to. Now, if you know anything about plants, plants need a couple essential things to grow, right? Like what? Well, they need water, they need air, they need soil, they need sunlight to grow. You probably will remember from biology photosynthesis, right? Right? Some of you guys maybe. But I'll give you a little refresher. It is the vine's job, this part right here, Jesus, the vine's job that is connected to the soil to absorb the water and the nutrients to bring it up and give it to the branches so that they can grow and be transformed and then bear fruit. Jesus, you guys, he does the heavy lifting in your life to cause you to be formed and transformed. How cool is that? It gets better. And then so the sun, right? Photosynthesis, you need the sun of God. The sun shines down on the plant, right? Converting the sugar that then gives it energy so that the water is pulled up and they work together to bear fruit and it's transformed. In fact, in the Greek, photosynthesis, photo means light. Synthesis means to place in. I love that, right? To be placed in the light. To place yourself in the light. To place yourself in the light. If you know anything about the Gospel of John, it's the book where Jesus refers to himself more than any other gospel as the light of the world. So when we abide in the vine, God does the heavy lifting that comes and brings the power that we need to grow and be transformed. And then the sun comes down and shines and gives us the power and the energy that we need to be transformed. He pours himself out for us. The vine nourishes you. And Christ's energy empowers you so that you can bear fruit. Fruit that this dying world so desperately needs right now. So that you can be an agent of change for the kingdom of God on this earth. That you might reveal heaven to a dying world. I believe, you guys, that this is the most important thing. In fact, it is the thing that makes you a disciple, you being connected to him always. Jesus does not command you to bear fruit. He simply commands you, us, to remain connected to him, and then fruit inevitably will come. So my question is, are you connected to the vine? Are you connected to him? Now, light. Light imagery, like I said, throughout John is everywhere. For example, after Jesus saves the girl caught in adultery in John chapter 8, he then is standing before a bunch of Pharisees and people in front of the temple, and he says this to them. He says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." Just as in John 15:1, if you noticed, he starts with two very important words, "I am." And if you were a good student when you were in Sunday school, then you know exactly what Jesus is saying here, right? Right? Jesus is making a very, very bold claim about who he is. Jesus is basically just saying, "I am God. I am Yahweh." He says it, I think, 70-something times in the Gospel of John, more than any other book. This claim is that he himself is the great I am. He is Yahweh. He is the God who created heaven and earth. It is the name of God given to Moses in Exodus chapter 3, the personal name of God. And in Genesis chapter 1, we see that this God is the God who speaks creation into existence. In fact, it says in Genesis 1, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be," what? "Light. Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw the light, and it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. So good. So in the beginning, it starts off with darkness. And in the Hebrew thought life, darkness really meant chaos and disorder. Chaos and disorder. And light in the Hebrew thought life meant order. So in the beginning, it is God's light that brings order to the disorder and the chaos of the cosmos. And because of that is sustaining life. So when Jesus says in John 8 and throughout the Gospel of John, "I am the light of the world," those Jewish hearers would know what he is saying. He's saying he's the one who brings life. And I believe this to be true on a cosmic scale, but I also believe this to be true on an individual scale for us here today. I think this is what happens when we come to Jesus and we let his light cover us, when we let his light into our life. In fact, in John 1:4, he says, "The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone." When we allow Jesus into our life, he brings order to our chaos within. He brings order to our souls. He brings order to our inner life. No matter what's happening around us, if we abide in Jesus, his light will flood us with peace and joy and order. How many of you need that today? Me too. I'm not talking about what's going on outside of you guys, what's going on at your job. I'm not talking about what's going on between you and your in-laws. I am talking about what's going on between you and Jesus. I'm talking about the chaos within us, the depression, the numbness, the fear, the anxiety. Because if you want to be any good to anyone outside, you need to get it right in here first. And it starts with the light of the world and letting him come in and restore you so that you can be beneficial to anything of change for the kingdom of God on this earth. And I believe this is what enables us. This is what enables us to love everyone, including our enemies. When we get it right in here, we're able to even face suffering. We're even able to die for those who hate us. This is what John 15 is all about. This is what he's saying. So, disciples, do you want to abide in the vine? Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you so much for your good news, God. I thank you for your faithfulness and your connectedness to the Father that enabled you to go to the cross for us, God. Because